Welcome to the Coalition Tackles, a monthly review of the tactics and techniques employed by people, places and organisations who are using sport and physical activity to address some of the most pressing social challenges in the UK. It's brought to you by the Sport for Development Coalition, a network of more than 180 organisations who work together to enhance the positive impact of sport and physical activity. The coalition is supported by Sport England, Comic Relief, and Laureus Sport for Good. I'm Ollie Dutfield, the Executive Director of the coalition and the host of the Coalition Tackles. I'm joined this afternoon by LJ Rawlings, Chief Executive Officer of Youth Employment UK. We're going to discuss how sport and physical activity can respond to the unemployment and livelihood challenges that have really been accentuated by COVID-19. Please join the conversation this afternoon via social media using hashtag sportforemployability. LJ, thanks so much for joining us this afternoon.
Oh, thanks for having me, Ollie. It's really great to be here. I'm looking forward to this conversation.
Now, we're speaking this afternoon in the context of increases in youth unemployment, growing challenges with underemployment and the quality of work for those that are in jobs, and growing inequalities in access to the labour market. Now, I'm not going to let our time this afternoon go by without getting your insight on these issues. But to start, I want to rewind to pre-pandemic and start our discussion by looking at the approach of Youth Employment UK. And I've long been struck by the three-pronged approach that you take, starting with young people, engaging employers, and then really trying to provide insight to policymakers. Be interested, why have you made this approach really core to your efforts to try to tackle youth unemployment?
Yeah, it's a good question. And I think back to when I founded the organisation and really could see there was a lot of policy changes back in 2011. You'll perhaps remember we had the coalition government for the first time take stage in Westminster. So we had the Conservatives and the Liberal Democrats really trying to redefine the policy landscape as a coalition. There was lots of policy creation, lots of austerity and budget cuts that were also kind of part of their mandate. So we were seeing policy directly affect the life chances of young people. They axed the connection service. They took out quite a lot of the vocational learning from our schools to prioritise on the EBAC, the E-Baccalaureate, the academic kind of GCSE and A-level routes. So policy really does affect young people. And I think that time of policy was quite central. We had youth unemployment at 1 million. There were 1 million NEET, not in education, employment or training, young people at the time, and government cutting budgets to the services that young people really relied on. So I wanted to represent and create an organisation that would tell young people's stories, that would put them at the heart of the debate. That's really important. We start there. I've actually got a commercial background, and you know, I think about my commercial career in sales and marketing. You don't create a product for a customer without talking to the customer or testing it. And yet actually, whether it's government or the third sector or employers, we're constantly inventing services and products for young people without really inviting them to be part of that co-design or testing and learning. So for us, you know, what was really important was making sure that we weren't talking for young people, that we were talking with young people. And that stood the test of time and is absolutely distinctly one of our successes. Young people want jobs, they want good quality jobs. So then we had to try and, you know, affect employer behaviour and coach and support employers to understand what good quality jobs really mean for young people and how to be youth friendly. But of course, then none of that was ever going to work if government policy wasn't geared up to those needs of those young people. And if they kept making changes from central London that would affect kids in my hometown in Corby that, you know, will never set foot in Westminster, you know, most likely in their lives. So it was important that if we're truly to tackle youth unemployment, you have to attack all of its problems. And the problems are, you know, young people don't know what skills they need, what careers exist. They have so much inequality, you know, there's such a difference as to what they are served by the systems around them to employer behaviour, to sort of that government dynamic as well. So, yeah, if you're going to do the job, as my mother always says, do it properly.
I love that point you made. You wouldn't create a product without speaking to the customer. And I think when we talk about policy or indeed more inclusive employment, quality employment, really great takeaway. And given the current trajectory of youth unemployment, youth employability, a key takeaway at this time. And I mean, talking of that trajectory around the relevant statistics and data on youth unemployment, the latest round of official employment statistics and analysis doesn't make light reading, unfortunately. I think we've seen 12 months to March 2021, over 800,000 jobs lost, and over half of those, I think 54%, young people, and overall over 2 percentage point increase in youth unemployment and similar decreases in young people in employment. I think the latest round of statistics, there is just over 50% of young people now in employment. Probably just concerning for me, and you shared some of your own research, that the issue of long-term unemployment is also a real challenge, such that the number of young people out of work for 6 months or more has risen by over 50% in the last year. But look, taking all those statistics and I guess translating them, what do they mean for young people, for employers and for policymakers at this time?
Well, I might stay just a minute on the theme of pre-pandemic. And actually, pre-pandemic, we had two high levels of youth unemployment. You know, there were over 700,000 young people not in education, employment or training pre-pandemic. And those young people are most often are vulnerable young people, are young people that face multiple layers of disadvantage. They are young people who have, you know, experienced poverty and disadvantage. They're young people from the care system, they're young people with disabilities and mental health needs, and they are young people from, you know, Black, Asian and ethnic minority communities. So we've never solved youth unemployment. And certainly, you know, as I say, there was 1 million young people meet in 2012. We were still nearly 800,000 in 2020. And so there was so much work that needed to be done. But the pandemic has, of course, you know, widened all of those gaps in society. If you were disadvantaged going into the pandemic, you had such a disadvantaged experience of the pandemic. You were more likely to lose your job or be placed on furlough. You were likely to be living in, you know, conditions of poverty, and that poverty will have been amplified during this last 15 months. So it's really important to remember that the pandemic hasn't caused high levels of youth unemployment. It's exacerbated a system that doesn't work for young people. But what we are seeing, you know, and interestingly, we saw the rise in employment in this last quarter. So the Office of National Statistics released their latest employment data for all ages. And there was a rise. There's been some bounce back. You can start to see that in all age data. But young people are still 14% more likely. There is over 14% of young people who are likely to be unemployed compared to 4.6% of all ages. So young people are fared off much worse in the pandemic because they are twice as likely to be working in the sectors that were shut down, hospitality and catering. I started my first real career in hospitality and catering. Not only are they sectors that have shut down to young people, but they were also the sectors that offered the most amount of work experience opportunity. And that's going to play out still to come. So What we know is that those young people who were disadvantaged before this are going to be further disadvantaged. And that's a real worry. When you start to see the long-term unemployment trend increase, even though youth unemployment as a whole is decreasing, it's that number of young people long-term unemployed, because once you're 6 months or more unemployed, the scarring effect takes place. And that is, you know, on your mental health and well-being and on your long-term social economic status. It is much harder if you've spent 6 months unemployed to compete with your peers who had no period of unemployment in terms of salary and career progression across your lifetime. That's not even a short-term thing. That's a lifetime cycle. So there is a lot to be concerned about in this data, and why some of it feels quite positive. And of course, you know, there'll be plenty of positive spin. You know, Youth Employment UK and our partners are keeping our eye well and truly on those young people who are furthest from the labour market.
Now, this point that you made around those furthest from the labour market, you spoke about the long-term and those who are long-term unemployed. And if you're going to categorise the key responses, and particularly across the groups of employers and then policymakers, what would you like to see, and what does that situation mean for those groups in particular?
So in March last year, I and four colleagues from other organisations set up a specialist policy group called the Youth Employment Group. So it's co-chaired by myself at Youth Employment UK, Impetus, Youth Futures Foundation, Prince's Trust, and the Institute for Employment Studies. And for the last 16 months, we've practically lived together in this world of policy and the impact of COVID on youth unemployment. The group now, it's a voluntary group, has over 250 members. And we've really, as a collective, worked hard to support government's response to the impact of COVID. You know, and actually quite quick off the blocks were government officials and policymakers looking to find the programs that have worked in the past for sudden high levels of unemployment to try and recreate a system that would support young people. I mean, the job retention scheme is unprecedented, you know, and it's a word branded around a lot with the recession, isn't it? Sorry, with COVID, is unprecedented. But, you know, honestly, it's still protecting people from unemployment. And that's quite a feat, given that, you know, we had no idea 14 months ago that we'd still be in a pandemic and still be in some form of restriction. So government had, you know, really turned the tide quite quickly. The plan for jobs was an, you know, initiative born out of Boris Johnson calling for an opportunity guarantee, which is in part a call that we made to government from the Youth Employment Group. And, you know, the Treasury came up, Rishi Sunak came up with Kickstart and as part of his plan for jobs. So there was investment for Kickstart, which is for young people who are on universal credit, and it provides employers the cost of their salaries to work for 25 hours a week, because work experience is critical. Young people need work experience to gain work experience, which is crazy, but it's the world in which we're in. And we know that. So work experience opportunities, paid for work experience opportunities, have been created through Kickstart, further investment in traineeships, further investment into apprenticeships and incentives for employers to create those opportunities. What I think we're still calling for is a coordination. You still see quite a lot of tensions between programs. You know, Kickstart can compete with a traineeship in terms of outcome for young person. Is the young person choosing the paid for work experience or the unpaid for opportunity of a traineeship? You know, some of that really needed better coordination across government, better language going out, and a joined up view on that. So we're really keen to see that youth employment becomes and remains a government priority, but sits probably centrally across government rather than in piecemeal bits with different departments, because you get a different approach and that's not working. Youth hubs was something that was created, and we know you need good national policy delivered at a local level. And so youth hubs was another policy that came out of the plan for jobs, and they could have the potential of changing a lot of that dynamic at a local level for young people. But they need investment. They need better, you know, kind of steer of responsibility. So there's still quite a bit of work that needs to be done there, and we're calling for that. Kickstart extension and the extension to things like the apprenticeship support for employers, they are going to need to still be in place beyond this year. So most of those programs will come to an end this year or early next. And actually, what we saw when we went into the recession in 2008, youth unemployment didn't peak to that 1 million marker until 2011. So it can take nearly 3 years for young people to kind of really come through the system. You know, what we're seeing this year is young people stay on in education. So where they might have left in 2019 and chosen to go into the labour market, right now they've chosen to do another year or do an extension or a master's or go to college instead of go and find work. So there is a lot of that still to play out in the system before we'll see youth employment peak. So actually, we want some of those employer incentives to remain in place until we know we're genuinely on the downward trend of tackling youth unemployment. And we're not going to see that for a little while yet. So there are a selection of the policy are some good, some have some potential, but there is much more to do and it's not over yet.
Spoken there around employer incentives, spoken there around some skills guarantees, but particularly some points there on work experience, the importance of work experience, and importance of different types of work experience and access to those opportunities. But hear a bit more later in the Southerners podcast around some young people's experience in that regard. But at this juncture, I really wanted to reflect in then on and start to look at potential role or contribution of sport, physical activity, sport for development as a sector, because there are a lot of young people who do gain experience, have opportunity for experience, localised experience through that sector. You recently contributed to the Coalition's Adapt Support Respond initiative and provided a thought starter and a blog on responses that the sector could make to current challenges faced in terms of youth unemployment. You made a comment, you said, working in and through sport offers us one way into the social contract that we need for our young people. I'm interested what you meant by this and why do you see sport and I suppose the intentional use of sport in particular playing a role in this regard?
So, I love your sector. I think your sector has so much potential here. And I've worked directly with some of your members of the Sports Development Coalition, who are fantastic organisations and really, really, truly passionate about their role in helping young people. At Youth Employment UK, we run a piece of research every year called the Youth Voice Census, which is a massive survey that goes out to the young people in our network who are 14 to 24 and asks them about, you know, their confidence levels, what they know about the world of work, what they're excited about, what they're worried about, what support they've had in school, what more we could do as a society to help them on that journey to work. And each and every year we hear young people really, you know, talk to us about their confidence levels and anxiety. And you know, we see that a lack of networks is a problem. We see a lack of experiences is a problem. And so, you know, I think here this is where, you know, the sport development sector can really play to a lot of those challenges. You know, young people, and I've seen it with, as I say, some of your partners, but I was particularly struck with some work that the Barclay Foundation did in London, where, you know, they began that soft engagement, that building of trust that's really important for young people through sport. So rather than come to this employability workshop, it's come, you know, come and engage and have some fun and come and, you know, meet your peer group and play football or whatever. My sport's rugby, so let's stick with what I know. Come down and play some rugby. And then it's through that building of trust, that building of networks, that you can then, when a young person is comfortable and feeling safe, you can build the building blocks for everything else. You know, you cannot get a good output from an employability program or a CV workshop if that young person is socially anxious, if they're fearful, if they don't have trust of the delivery model and what that looks like. And I think sport or music or, you know, the art sector has got so much to give in terms of taking the pressure off, engaging in where that young person is in their life with something they're interested in doing, and building from there and building that trust. We led a piece of research with Newcastle University back in 2016, I think, called The Role of the Family in Social Mobility. And it taught us that, you know, in order for a young person to become socially mobile, they need from their parents a transfer of capital, social capital, economic capital and cultural capital. Now, social mobility has been going backwards for 20 odd years. You know, it's been stagnant and now it's going backwards. The parents can't transfer that capital. There are too many families that don't have that capital to support their children. Our children, you know, my children, I think about the privilege that they are in just by luck of who they were born to. So for me, it's where organisations within your network, within the coalition and informal rugby clubs can help support that transfer of capital, whether that's social, economic or cultural. It bridges some of the gaps that some of our most disadvantaged young people experience through no fault of their own. So I think there's a lot to play for when it comes to sport being a conduit to supporting the social mobility of our young people.
A number of the organisations that are so taking a lot of the approaches that you spoke about there on the conversation this afternoon, I'd encourage them and others, please do add your insights, thoughts, share your case studies and learning using hashtag sport for employability. But a lot of your insights there resonated closely with what we heard during the last week when the Coalition Tackles producer, Simon Lansley, took a virtual trip, still a virtual trip, to Stoke and Harrogate town to get a bit of a feel from young people around some of the opportunities for employment in sport, challenges that they're facing entering employment in and through sport. And indeed, you spoke before around government's kickstart scheme. He looked at the impact that's having, the initial impact that's having in supporting access to some of these opportunities. So I'll pass over now to Simon.
So delighted to welcome Lucy Shuttleworth, who is overseeing the EFL's trust involvement with the Kickstart project, and two young people who are currently on the programme, Henry Whittaker, who is working with Harrogate Town, and Taylor Oakley, who is coaching at Stoke City. Thanks for speaking to the Coalition Tackles podcast today, guys.
Thank you very much. Thanks for inviting us on.
Yeah, thanks for having us on.
Great stuff. Lucy, if I could come to you first. The Coalition has been looking at sport's contribution to the recovery from the COVID-19 pandemic. Can you tell me a little bit about what the Kickstart programme is and how the EFL Trust is supporting it?
Yeah, so the Kickstart scheme is a new programme sort of launched by the government last November. And it was to give funding for employers offering new entry-level roles for 16 to 24-year-olds who are currently in receipt of universal credit. So it was basically a programme that's aimed at preventing young people who are currently unemployed facing sort of long-term unemployment sort of post-pandemic. As we've seen, you know, a lot of sort of redundancies, young people unable to get jobs after school, lack of experience. So this is what this programme is aimed to do.
What's it like for young people out there at the moment? Are they getting jobs or, you know, how's the pandemic affected them?
I think the one word to use would be tough. I think that's the way to describe it best. I mean, I think a lot of industries are all competitive and at the best of times. And when COVID comes, there's just less jobs, isn't there, available for everyone because everyone's trying to save the money, you know, keep businesses going. I mean, I had a few of my course mates who were really good at what they're doing, and a couple got into roles. They had them agreed before COVID hit, so they had a place in journalism sorted. But I've got a couple of really close mates who had, you know, got the same grades as me, and they can't get in. They can't get into the industry. You know, that they're applying for hundreds of jobs and having to go down different routes for just to get money in, really.
And Taylor, I understand you're is that right? You're coaching with Stoke.
I am.
Is that your passion, you know, coaching, working with young people?
Yeah, when I first started here, I wasn't too sure what I wanted to do. So I just came along as volunteering and then it just sort of grew from there. And I wasn't actually 100% sure, like at the start I was, because my confidence isn't the highest, like it grew over time.
Well, you say you're not so confident, but you're clearly very good at what you do because you seem to have sustained it for a long time. And the clubs seem to appreciate what you're doing, don't they?
Definitely, it's coming along.
Well, I think the big thing that I could take into, say, any interview or something, I could say I've worked in a COVID environment like for the past year at the age of 21, 22, just as a graduate, and I've come through at the other side and hopefully done a good enough job. You know, the role's probably been quite different in a COVID world to what it was beforehand, just how you talk to people. Like, even we'll have to talk on Zoom all the time now instead of meeting in person. That's different for people, especially going into a new job sometimes as well. Not being able to meet someone face to face as often as you want, you're meeting them maybe for the first time on a Zoom call. It's different, but I think what you said earlier about like the transferable skills you get, I mean, yeah, just so important. And I feel like I'm in a much better position now than I was a year ago to go into any job, to be honest.
If you could tell me a bit more about the variety of roles that the young people are undertaking.
So, yeah, you know, you think of a football club typically, and you've spoke about there, Simon, sort of previously around that we do, you know, you think of the football coaching and sort of maybe the media a little bit, as such as Henry and Taylor's roles. But you've got everything and anything from sort of, we've got assistant groundsmen, we've got cleaners, we've got HR assistants, finance, even looking at within the football club and the actual, you know, the first teams and academies, is that looking at the academy strength and conditioning coach or an analyst. You know, a lot of these young people who haven't gone to university yet, you know, again, they're entry level roles, so coming on board, having a sort of go at whether that's going to be something that interests them, and getting that foot in the door and experience is just invaluable to them. And we've had so many case studies that come through, which is a real shock, and you know how long young people have been out of work in the lockdown period. You know, sort of one of the questions we ask is, you know, how long have you been looking for work? And a lot of it is sort of 18 months. We've got a vast sort of number of different caliber of young people with different qualifications. You know, some like Henry who've got a degree, who are struggling to break into the industry, right to, you know, school leavers that haven't been able to get a job sort of post-pandemic because there's just nothing for them around. So it's a real, we're really passionate about Kickstart and what it's doing for our local communities and young people.
So we've got some interesting insights there from Taylor, Henry and Lucy. Some themes there coming through: long-term unemployment, the need, foot in the door, and challenges to get the foot in the door in a range of sectors and a range of areas of employment, including within sport for development and physical activity. We've had a number of organisations from across the coalition network also join this conversation. Indeed, the conversation's going wider. Some of the challenges that Taylor, Henry and Lucy spoke about have been important themes at Street Games Power of Place Conference, which is taking place this week and next week. And you can follow the hashtag Sport for Employability feed to get some great insights coming out of that discussion. There's others in the network who are sharing more broadly opportunities in this sector, and Dallaglio Rugby Works and getting that message out at next week's 10,000 Black Interns Media, Arts, Sport and Careers Fairs. Some good discussion on socials from Coach Core and across the Active Partnership Network, who've really been engaging in the debate of how to strategically use sport in responding to the unemployment emergency. And if you follow the hashtag Sport for Employment, there's a great video from Coach Core around their plans to really work collaboratively across the sector. So please be part of that conversation on hashtag Sport for Employability. LJ, you mentioned before working with a number of these organisations who are using, if you like, sport-themed approaches to support employability outcomes, to support young people furthest from the labour market or who are long-term unemployed. And I think what's interesting is the work there is not without a level of evidence. We've got some of the impact reports from across the sector. Empire Fighting Chance, who utilise a really pioneering approach to link and boxing with mentoring and employability support. I mean, similar to what you explained, where had about 60% of the cohort in their intensive career programs progress into education, employment and training, with over 80% of their wider cohort with that link of boxing and different employability services. Leadership through sport and business, trying to really create some of those linkages into employers and those bridging capital and social capital you spoke about, LJ, with that sort of sport-themed approach for engagement. 90% of last cohort placed in employment after a year and having that sustained employment outcome. I mean, I think when we, though, talk about the role sport and physical activity can play, really important that we don't present it as a panacea. And the processes, the conditions, the mechanisms, the methodology utilising sport-themed approaches or linking other services, sport and physical activity offers, is absolutely essential. Now, if you're reflecting on what's been coming in on the social media platforms, your engagement with those organisations that are using sport-themed approaches, what would be your sort of top tips to organisations who are really looking to harness and utilise those assets of sport to help deliver employability outcomes for young people?
Gosh, it's a big, good question. I just say, you know, that 90% outcome for leadership through sport is huge. You know, there are organisations who only specialise in employability and preparing, you know, people back into work or preparing them for work that have less high percentages, you know. So that's testament, really, to the work that's going on and the quality of those programmes. So, you know, brilliant stats there. I think for me, that one of the challenges I see, you know, I'm still sometimes feel I'm quite new to the world of youth employment, only being 10 years in, but there's such an inconsistent approach. The quality of programs is really inconsistent for young people, and that's a big frustration for me, because, you know, a CV workshop is a CV workshop. You know, a good CV, the rules to that are fairly simple and straightforward and universal. And yet we're forever investing in recreating CV workshops and sticking plasters on them. And I don't think that's the problem. You know, I think for young people, and we do a lot of work around this, that there is a much more holistic approach that is needed. So advertising to be an employability program or a, you know, CV workshop style program isn't enough anymore. Young people, you know, need more personalized support, and, you know, they ask for it every year when we get the Youth Voice Census results. The thing that young people tell us they want the most is one-to-one, someone to listen to them and to support them at an individual level, which is where I think sport can play a really great role, because you learn about your players in a team, right? You learn their strengths and their weaknesses on or off the pitch. And so you're geared to that thinking, to that individualized planning of you know, what training needs does, you know, the left back have. You know, they're going to need to do some more fitness training. They're going to need some more cardio. They need to work on, you know, sort of a particular skill set. So we do that in sport, but we don't necessarily do that when we're running then a CV program for 30 young people that we just plonk in front of computers. So I think there is something very much for me about individualizing the support that is there for young people. And I think there's a lot of potential for this sector to demonstrate that impact. But also, we use a framework here at Youth Employment UK, and it wasn't designed by us, but it's called the Journey to Employment Framework. And it shows that, you know, holistically, a young person needs 7 factors to be working for them in order for them to be able to move on into employment. An employability skills program is one factor, absolutely, that you need those good employability skills. Employers looking for them, you need a good CV. You know, we've just recruited, and actually, you know, we're recruiting for a senior position here, director level, and I've rejected half the candidates based on their poor quality CV. So we need to understand what the hell is going wrong in CV guidance, because it's an all-age thing, not just a young person thing. But they're just 2 of 7 factors. factors. We need to support young people emotionally, personally. You know, if they have personal barriers to employment, like they can't afford the bus fare to an interview, we need to make sure our programs understand that and remove that barrier for that young person with that young person. And it goes across to things like qualifications, because when all is said and done, employers are looking for some skin in a game. And so that might be informal qualification, but nevertheless, that it's an element of what young people need, the work experience or the social action evidence to show that they can apply their skills then in different settings. So I think for me, there's a really interesting ask as to, you know, out of those two organizations that you've just shown the stats for, are they measuring the same thing? You know, are they using the same outputs and framework measures to show their return on, you know, investment? They're probably not. We don't do it in the employability sector, the truer employability sector. So I should be pretty surprised if you did it in the sport development sector. But it's available, and we could measure better, and we could better design programs so they really did provide that holistic support and evidence what's going on. Because all of the informal stuff you put into a program, and your coaches will be, there'll be loads of that informal stuff. You could be measuring that. And the more of that you measure, one, the young person is better off for it. But two, you're better placed to evidence the true impact, the true depths of your programs. And I think that's, for me, is something to really work on. Put the young person first, and, you know, develop programs based on individuals and not one size fits all, because that's just, you know, we know better than that. And then use consistent frameworks and measurements so that we can learn together and build on programs, but better for this sector to build its collective impact, because that message then to government or to commissioners, it becomes much more interesting, right?
Takes me back to your comments early, when to design a product without speaking to the customer. So put the young people at the centre of the design. But the very individualised approach, I think, becomes critical across those successful programs, but doing it in a holistic way. And that comparability of how we measure successes, outcomes, impacts that can run across sectors and be understood and recognised, I think, is a really important takeaway. Also, remind me when we go offline to get a quick CV course from you, because it sounds like a whole user there. But this sort of approach, this holistic approach, really resonates. There's three of the leading sort of employability charities, youth employment charities, using sport within the coalition: Sport for Life, Street Games, and Street League, and they're involved in a Europe-wide project, really helping to understand an intersection of sport-themed approaches and that holistic employment, and looking at how that can be effectively monitored, evaluated, but more importantly, effectively designed in a holistic approach. So, good chance now to look at some reflections from an individual within one of those programs, working with one of those organisations. And during the week, Simon again took a virtual trip to Birmingham to speak to Zoe Littlewood, who is involved with Sport for Life.
Oh, hi there. Yeah, delighted to welcome Zoe Littlewood, who is been working with Sport for Life UK in Birmingham. Hi, Zoe.
Hi, how are you? You okay?
Oh, I'm very well, thank you. Yeah. So, Zoe, it's been a strange year or two, to say the least, hasn't it? How has the pandemic affected you and personally, and also with regards to the first steps in your career?
Oh, you can say that again. It's been a crazy year or two for sure. So for me personally, I graduated university in 2019, September. So very lucky to have a graduation. And due to uni being quite stressful, I decided to take time out. So for the first bit, well, the end of 2019, I took time out. So I wasn't really going into my career. However, as we know, COVID-19 hit us and my career then became impossible to do. So I can't remember if I said it, but I'm a sports therapist. And as you'd be aware, our hands are our bread and butter. I assess for a living. I move joints around. That's my go-to. And due to COVID not allowing that, I was like, okay, what am I going to do? The degree that I'd studied for 3 years to get a job in the end, I can no longer do at the minute. And it pushed me like right back. I was like, okay, what am I going to do? So for me, it was like a nightmare, honestly. Everything just, all my ideas just went right out the window. So I was left kind of just searching endlessly for a job that didn't involve touching people, which was weird because that was my go-to. That's what I knew. That's what I was passionate about.
Okay. So do you think that's been a common experience? What do you think it's been like for young people applying for jobs during the pandemic?
Well, it would have been difficult, right? Because I know a lot of us young people, our jobs that we go for are in the travel industry. It's in the hospitality industry. So with those being the most worst hit for us young people, we were completely hit. A lot of us, you come out of uni, you don't have a stable job or any job. So I didn't have a job when I left because I'd stopped working. It was hard, very, very hard to handle. But like I said, there was just no jobs out there. You can understand, and I understood it. Employers already had that decision, that hard decision of I'm going to have to get rid of some staff. So I couldn't see them wanting to get me involved. Like someone who has nothing to do with their company and not really going to want to hire me during this time. And it's been a hard cycle for us young people. And we've definitely been affected with not being able to get any jobs at the moment. For me personally, I'm a social butterfly. I love to go out and talk to people. That's just in my nature. I'm quite a bubbly person. So to be told you're locked down, you can't do anything, see anyone, I took that really hard because I like speaking. To be honest, I speak for England, but I just like to be with people and socially connect. And I feel like my generation, we like to do that. We like to just go chill in the park with our friends. So the fact that couldn't happen, that was already quite a hard thing. But then when you add on the added stress of, okay, I'm in my early 20s, I have bills to pay. Maybe they're not your bug standard like gas, electric, but I've still got my phone bill, my gym bill, my contacts. I've got bills to pay, no income coming in. What am I going to do? I can't see my friends to physically vent out to them my issues. I'm trapped at home, and you can imagine it's quite a vicious cycle. And then mental health just completely goes out the window because for me, there was no escape personally to start off with. But I can imagine it'd be very similar for all young people. We just love to get out and just be free. And like he says, these are our early years, our years to kind of like spread our wings, make mistakes, make experiences, have memories, and we couldn't do it, completely just cut. I've always known, especially doing sports, that there's more to just doing the sport. You learn communication skills, team building skills, problem solving skills whilst actually playing sports. But it's very hard for a young person to see that they're learning those skills because they just see it as playing a sport, which you are doing. But when you're playing a sport, especially football, you've got to think of the problem solving aspect of it. I don't want him to get through my defense, so I'm going to line up this way. That's what I think people are starting to understand, that sports is not just kicking a ball or throwing a ball. It's actually the mind and the process behind. And you can give young people so many skills just by playing sports. And that's what I really, really enjoy.
That's fantastic. Thank you so much for your time, Zoe. And,
thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Okay.
It's more than just sport, I think. A really important message there from Zoe, and she touched on some key parts of that sort of holistic, interconnected approach within effective sport-themed employability program. And that's engaging young people through the sport and finding that different non-traditional platform to support some aspects of personal development. We also saw in the imagery there the provision of mentoring and employability support programs around the sport-based activities. And you know, I know that there's a number of coalition members working with that sort of approach to sort of proactively support young people and then link them on to employers. We saw on the social medias the work of Rangers Charitable Foundation and Coach Corps with those support services linked to their sort of sport-based programming, and they've been shared through the online conversation. And to close this afternoon, it'd be great to have some additional insights into how organisations in the network are taking that sort of a holistic approach that LJ's spoken about. But look, LJ, hearing from Zoe, really took me back to the start point of our conversation and the real importance of a youth-led approach, but also engaging employers and providing that insight to policymakers from that youth-led approach and from that youth-centred approach, and in particular, a point you made, addressing long-standing structural issues that are impacting young people's economic participation and employability, which run well earlier than the pandemic, but of course have been exacerbated by the challenges we face in the last year and a half. So to finish up, I want to put a hypothetical or a situation to you. I noted with interest earlier this month, the British Chambers of Commerce had their virtual conference. And I just noticed it because they said they represent about 73,000 businesses. It's about 6 million people employed across those businesses. So to finish our discussion this afternoon, if you could get sort of one message to that group of employers or a wider group of employers from young people, what would it be? And then what would does government need to do to ensure that message really lands?
I think it's the same ask. Talk to young people. You know, it is too easy to assume, you know, both you and I, Ollie, were 16 once. It's too easy to assume we know what young people want because we were once 16 and 17 and 18. But actually, you know, gosh, I have a 16-year-old who's just about to finish his first year of A-levels. So he's experienced the pandemic in all of its, you know, glory or otherwise, but missed his GCSEs because of the pandemic, missed his A-level, you know, 160 odd days did Sir Kevin Collins say that our students have missed out of education. We can't assume we know what that feels like and what those young people want. So businesses, if you're creating opportunity, and you should, because actually this group of young people coming through our education system and you know, into their early careers are brilliant. They're brilliantly talented. They're brilliant, you know, empathetic to the world. They care about the system in which they live and work in. They bring so much potential, but you have to talk to them. You have to go out there and meet them in their places, in the places that they are creating social mobility employment programs from, you know, the 52nd floor in Canary Wharf is not going to set the world alight. That's what I know. And the sooner I'm back out in the communities that I support, the better, because it keeps me true as a leader. And I think the same for government. I think government should be accountable to young people. We should all be accountable. If we're designing programs with young people should be part of our accountability too. I think it'd be really interesting, you know, flip out Kickstart as an example. If there was a forum of young people that Kickstart designers and delivery partners were responsible to feeding back to, I wonder if that might change the dynamic of the program, if they actually had to present back to young people what they had done with that investment and with that program. So we have a youth board here, and one of my young volunteers who started with me when he was 16 is now actually a full-fledged director on our board of directors. We had a board meeting this morning and Patrick was, you know, in the room contributing in equal measure to my other board members. You know, I hold myself accountable to the young people we're trying to serve in as many ways as I can. So I think there is something about the accountability. Who are we accountable to? And certainly talk to, and don't assume we know just because many moons ago, for some of us, we were once in the age demographic. And I think, you know, when I look at the organisations you've showcased today, you know, some of them are members, you know, Sport for Life and Leadership Through Sport have been connected to us for a long time. They are brilliant organisations who truly are committed to that agenda. They want to hear that expertise. They want to hear that voice of young people. They want to know what our annual census data is telling us so they can use it to design programmes. You know, it's a really good approach, and I think shows their success in their program and their deliveries over the last, you know, certainly over this last pandemic months too. So, yeah, I think we have to be more curious about young people in our work.
And I like your point, not just listening, but that accountability back to young people. An interesting point you made there around also young people, those life transitions school into higher education or the workforce. We heard today from challenges from higher education into the workforce. And I don't want the time to pass this afternoon without really applauding in that regard Youth Employment UK's Create Your Future campaign, or hashtag Create Your Future. And I think that focus of that campaign are really supporting young people who are at key education or employment transitions is really important. And I encourage those across the Sport for Development Coalition and beyond to really link into that campaign and promote and highlight the opportunities within sport and physical activity for young people at those key life transitions. And while I'm encouraging interaction, also please do continue to share case studies and learning, both through the hashtag Sport for Employability, but shortly we will be launching a call for submissions from across the sector and the organisations that are using sport within employability programs and really working towards supporting employment and employability outcomes for young people to inform a more detailed report and analysis on this issue and a policy brief. And you can see there and visit sportfordevelopmentcoalition.org, Coalition Tackles, to get more information on those submissions and that call for evidence, learning and case studies. There's also a lot else going on this week. It is National School Sport Week. We talk about those education transitions, and please do visit youthsporttrust.org and participate in the work there, celebrating the important role of sport and physical activity within education. And we're all looking forward to the 4th of July and Thank You Day, opportunity to look back and really say thank you to those who have supported community cohesion, supported togetherness over the really challenging year and a half, and encouraging sport organisations, those in the coalition and beyond, to get involved in that day and host really community sporting activities and link them and use them as an opportunity to be part of that national thank you campaign. You can go to streetgames.org to get more information on Thank You Day. So those few advertisements done, LJ, look, thanks very much for your time this afternoon, but more so the insights that you've provided both on the broader landscape around youth employment, but particularly that advice and guidance for those who are utilising sport and physical activity to really contribute to those outcomes. It'd be great to speak this afternoon.
Oh, thanks for having me, and I look forward to supporting your sector and advocating for it as much as I can.
Great. And I also pass out thanks to Taylor Oakley from Stoke City, Henry Whittaker from Harrogate Town, and Lucy Shuttleworth from the EFL Trust, Zoe Littlewood from Sport for Life, and everyone on the coalition and beyond who've contributed to the conversation today via social media. And last but not least, the producer of Coalition Tackles, Simon Lansley. So you can keep following the Coalition Tackle podcast on the Podbean platform. With that, we'll see you next month on the Coalition Tackles.